is the feeling. Take me to the garden. I wanna feel my belonging.
Coming up in the Garden of Eden tonight.
You are welcome in the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor this Sunday evening. Yes, how was your day, Mr. Farmer, Miss Garden? What have you been up to? I have told you guys, every time I come into the garden, I come when I'm excited, when I'm happy, because I anticipate you that is on the other side of the camera. You're watching, you're learning with the marriage anchor. We are walking. Yes, we are together, journeying, returning to the Garden of Eden. And I have told you, this is not just me coming and entertaining you, Nemba, Chamula, Neda. I have told you, every time I come and teach, it is a journey, it is a relationship. We are going somewhere, and tonight I'm excited where we are headed, because yes, I am not alone. This season is quite interesting. It is exciting to see the marriage anchor bringing different people that have different experiences. Yes, about relationship, about marriage, the challenges, what we have to go through to ensure that this institution, this, you know, relationship that we get into, husband and wife, man and woman, actually becomes the dream that we always have before we get into it. So it is important that, yes, you don't only hear from the marriage anchor, but we bring different people to have different perspectives, especially in this season. And yes, tonight is no different. Okay, so before I introduce our special guest that I have imported, you will soon know where he's coming from. We are going to be discussing relationships of media personalities. My life. Am I a media personality? I think so. Sometimes when people tell me, marriage anchor, you are a celebrity, I'm like, you guys, I think I'm working on it. I'm not yet there. I'm still, you know, yeah, baby steps. I think I may be 10, I don't know how many years to come, I will become a celebrity. If I have done anything anyway, that is worth celebrating. But yes, tonight in the Garden of Eden, we are going to be discussing relationships of people that are in positions of influence, people that are on social media, TV personalities, people that you see on TV, people that you never get to interact with. You see us on TV and you imagine, I don't know what you guys imagine, you think we don't make mistakes, we should be perfect, we should be, and you have expectations of these people. So we are going to see the fact that they are in the public eye every other time. How does that actually impact their relationships, their marriage, their love life, the good, the bad, the ugly, the scandals, the drama, the shred, all that. We are going to be discussing it tonight, and of course giving you a solution. We'll have to make sure you can be a public figure, you can be a media personality, and still have a successful relationship or marriage. Because they are here says that are not so nice. And I have seen lots of things that happen in the media. Anyway, without further ado, allow me introduce our guest for tonight, my boss. When he walked in here, I am a person that's very open. What you see is what you get. He walked in here and I said out a compliment. I said something out loudly because that's who I am. So when I was walking down to go and, you know, prepare, pick something where we prepare before we come on set, I was like, should I have said that publicly? And then I'm like, but Prosy, that's who you are. Guess what I said? He walked in into the room and I said, oh, good to see you, my fine boss. So yes, my fine boss, you're welcome in the Garden of Eden.
Thank you very much.
See, I have to first defend my compliments.
No, you've done a very good job. What an intro. Well done. Very excited to be on the set today.
You're welcome. So before we go into today's discussion, yes, just introduce a little bit of yourself. Are you married? We do not see your wife in the media. We don't know. Are you married? You have children?
Yes, very married. I've been married for 16 years now.
Wow.
Making 17 years this year in May. We have two beautiful daughters. And they are now in secondary school. Young teenagers. Yeah, and I've known my wife for about 20 years now. So it's been quite a journey together.
Okay. So I just told people that you are my boss. How? What did you do? How are you my boss?
Well, I am the Deputy Managing Director at Uganda Broadcasting Corporation. Mm-hmm. I do, of course, oversee television and radio departments at UBC.
Okay.
And so Garden of Eden, which is a property of the UBC TV, directly falls under my domain. And so, yes, I'm your colleague. I don't know why you say boss, but I'm your colleague.
You are my boss. That is a fact, especially if I'm here. I'm on a TV where you are deputy managing director. I have to be nice, lest I lose my contract.
I'm hoping you'll treat me the way you treat everyone else, which is really too
right
nice.
Right here in the garden?
Yes.
Okay, I will try. I don't know if I can. Anyway, so what is that one thing that you appreciate about being a media personality?
Well, there is a lot of privileges that come with being a media personality. Mm. I've been in journalism for 20 years.
Wow.
In journalism, and I've been fortunate to work only in the broadcast space, so I haven't worked in the print space. Mm. So there is a lot of advantages to that. Because it's broadcast, you get to be seen by a lot of people, and so your life kind of changes immediately you go on set, which is, you know, what we were discussing even before you went on air. And through your intro, I could see where you were going with the celebrity status.
Okay.
But so a lot of doors get open for you because of that, visibility you get on television. You get to work with amazing people like Prosy and interact with a lot of good people. Your network really grows because you meet as many important people in society, whether it's religious leaders, cultural leaders, and or politicians. And that builds quite a bit of your network. And a lot of these networks actually come to help you later in the future. And I've benefited from a lot of these networks along the way. And so after 20 years in the media, a lot of these networks are now beginning to bear fruit for myself and my family. When you want to get children into certain schools, when you want to get jobs in certain organizations, when you want to get, for example, business for UBC, you make some phone calls. And so that's been very good for me. And finally, you get to do also quite a bit of work outside your traditional space. And so I'm sure you've had a lot of our media personalities are influencers for different products and different companies. And so it's become an opportunity for media personalities to actually make money outside their traditional jobs. And so you've seen a lot of them very active on social media, where they're actually making some really good money. Some of them have literally transitioned to digital, but having made their brand and name on television.
Yes.
And so this is just a few of the many advantages you have. And as you may be aware, a lot of the media personalities that are on social media are getting their accounts verified. So you have people on social media who have a different personality than anyone else on social media because their accounts are verified, and so they get to get more followers. And traditionally, the followers turn out into a good audience for yourself, for your product and your brand. And so media is really a good vehicle, especially for people who want to be out there, but also want to build a profile that can do good for their communities, their families, and society.
We have seen people walk from the media houses, from being media personalities to politics, positions of influence, to actually even other big corporate jobs in organizations that are not media related.
Yes, very indeed. The current parliament, I think someone said there is about 20 members of parliament who are formerly journalists. And of course, everyone knows Joel Senyonyi. I worked with Joel before.
Yes.
Joel worked on UBC
before
he joined private media and before he joined politics. But yes, a lot of people have used the media platform. Sometimes I think they come to the media so they can actually get the platform to go into politics.
Okay.
So traditionally they're already politicians, but then they need a vehicle. So the vehicle becomes the media. And so the media gives you quite a bit of audience. I also know for a fact, for example, in my constituencies or in my, you know, where I grew up from, because I was raised in Kabale, I've had some, a home in Barara. A lot of those places, especially in Western Uganda, some of our members of parliament now were former radio presenters or radio talk show hosts. So they've built a profile on the platform that has actually catapulted them into politics.
Okay. That's interesting. Okay, so coming back to talking relationships of media personalities, how have you as an individual managed to keep your marriage life out of the media? And why did you do that?
Well, it was very intentional. And maybe because we burnt our fingers at the beginning. I met my wife, which is quite a bit of the conversation we are going to have today, in the media. And I'm not the only person, I think, who's, you know, found their better half in their workplace, because I was discussing this with a couple of colleagues before I came on the show. A lot of our professions almost determine who you're going to get married to.
Yes.
So you see a lot of doctors get married to doctors, a lot of teachers get married to teachers, and a lot of journalists get married to journalists.
Really?
And by the way, a lot of media personalities, that means TV presenters, TV show hosts, get actually married to people in the media industry. The most famous one, of course, right now is Flavia and Andrew Kabura. So you can see where I'm coming from. But really the key highlight of this for me, I think, is that when you're in our space, you must be a little careful about how much you bring in your family into the same space.
Your private life.
Yes. Mm. And especially, I agree, your private life. I have sisters and brothers who not many people know, because we've decided that's the way to go. I grew up in a very humble family, and my father always said, please remember you're coming from a humble family. This is who we are, and we're not going to change, whether you're on television or whether you become a politician. And so I have sisters in all sorts of professions. We have an engineer, we have an architect, one of them works in Australia. But we've kept that very private. So we meet, we are online. Those who know will know, but those who don't will never know that these are my sisters and we are siblings. And that is the same with our family. And we've thought that where we can, we'll share what we can share. But most of the time, a lot of our family and private content is private.
So for you, this is a family value that you have?
Yes, because you must protect the family.
Okay,
yeah. Family. It's very important.
Okay. Doesn't she complain? Okay, Banag, what's your wife's name?
Oh, Irene.
Irene,
right. Yes.
So doesn't she complain that, you know, you keep me behind the scenes? I want to be out there. I want people to know that, yes, I am the owner of this, you know?
Well, I don't think I keep her behind the scenes. I always make sure I say happy birthday to her formally, so the whole world can know it's a very special day in her life. We're not big on Valentine's, so you will not see anything. You'll not see us in red on Valentine's Day, but
we'll
have our private moments.
Okay.
So you will not see those in the public.
Publicly, you'll not do it publicly. Whatever
you will not
you
see
do
it.
Is. Okay.
You may find us somewhere, but that is going to be you chancing on us
not
in a place. But you won't find us on social media saying, this is who we are, this is where we are, this is how we are celebrating.
Don't you want to trend?
Well, that's a new thing for the young people. I think
we're
very
old
school. I think we're very old school. I don't know. We come from a space where we think that there are certain things that need to remain private.
Okay.
And I think one of them is relationships, family. These days I get worried when I see people posting their newborn babies online.
Exactly.
Or sharing the pictures of their children. My child goes to this school. Today I just dropped my child at this place.
Every other detail that...
In Europe it's a risk.
You're just throwing
that.
It out there to whom it may concern.
That's risky. In other countries, if you're a target, it's easy then to find your child.
Exactly.
Or if, you know, people... want to get ransom out of you, they could actually pick your child, claiming to be a relative. We now know that schools, for example, are asking us to have visitation cards. And so someone could just, you know, pretend they're part of your family and go see your child or your daughter or whoever it is, and God forbid what may happen. So I think we still are giving away too much, and we've decided as a family value to remain as humble as possible. But what we can, we try. Most recently, we went to one of the national parks. We went to Buru National Park. One of my daughters really insisted, we must go back to Buru National Park. And we did. But so we shared the pictures. We shared, but you don't share as much as you think everyone needs to know, but you share what you can.
Just basic.
So you show people you actually support domestic tourism, and it's important that we visit our national parks. But also try and keep the private moments very private.
Mm. if your daughter is to be in a relationship and they want to be live streaming everything, because I've seen lots of people are live streaming and their relationships when they wake up in the morning, others are doing pranks, content creation in the name of content creation on YouTube or whatever other platforms. Would you encourage or discourage your own daughter not to do that now in this generation?
Well, it actually depends. I've, you know, the last 20 years I've been in the content space, and I understand where digital content, production is coming from, and I understand the thirst and the appeal to keep your audience entertained.
Yeah.
Because I see it builds more audience, it gets you more viewership, it gets you more numbers, you know. And that translates later into money. All these social media platforms are being monetized, and so you make money out of these platforms by putting content on air. But I actually think you can develop great content that isn't necessarily about yourself.
Okay.
I know for a fact, for example, one of the people in the media space, Nancy Kachungira, who works for the BBC, I worked with before, got married recently.
Yeah.
I just saw her picture yesterday.
We saw the picture.
Yes. And if you notice, in one of the clips you'll be able to see her partner, but you don't see the partner, it's very difficult for you to see her partner, and she's kept that intentional.
Mm.
If you look at her Instagram page, you may never see her partner.
Okay.
And I think it's a good thing because you want to control the narrative on your platform.
Okay.
And so if my daughter decided that that's what she wants to do, I would be the first person to tell her these are the things you can and cannot do because of our own family values.
Mm.
So there will be private moments she cannot post online, and we will deal with that. And I will be able to say, you're allowed to stream. You can live stream ABCD, but you cannot do this or that on social media. Mm. I've seen my wife actually tell my daughters to delete some of their pictures on their platforms. We are not on all their platforms because remember, they're on Snapchat, they're on TikTok, we are not there. But sometimes she gets to see, because it's important to check on what your teenage daughters are doing on social media. And so I've seen her tell them, delete this. No, I don't like that picture. Remove it. Why are you doing that? So there is this new trend of a certain pause, and a certain facial expression. She'll literally tell them to bring them down. Yet it's a new thing. But I agree with her. You must be able to control what's on your social media platforms, because there is a risk at the end of the day that this could actually come to haunt you in the future. I don't know what you want to be in the future. I have seen people running for office, especially politicians, who have actually lost their official seats for what they said in the public space that was captured on social media, or what they actually posted, or what they actually did on social media. I'll give you a quick example. There was someone who was appointed on the board of the Kenya Tourism Board, just neighbors here in Kenya, a very young lady, very enterprising young lady, who really is an expert in the field of tourism, and had been appointed on the Kenya Tourism Board, which is really one of the most lucrative boards in the region, because Kenya's tourism is doing very well.
Okay.
She lost her portfolio because just after they had appointed her, it came to light that she had posted some very non-friendly, patriotic comments on her platform, on Twitter. And they had to recall her appointment. So you need to be very careful what you do on social media. And so I'd be one of the people telling my daughter what and what not to do.
All right, okay. So what are some of the disadvantages of being in the public eye, especially in your relationship or for your marriage in that matter?
Well, then your life is not private. So you have no single private life. The moment you're a public personality like Percy here, it doesn't matter where you are.
I have managed to keep my life very private.
Yeah, but you see, what happens is the moment you get out of your private space, that is your vehicle, your house, it ceases to be private. In fact, I don't know. I know you've been talking to lawyers in the recent past. I think the law protects people from even taking your pictures, because they can take your picture anytime, because you're a public personality. And the moment you step out of your private space, which is your home, your compound, and your car, you're no longer private.
Yeah.
You're now a public personality. And the fact that you're already in the public domain, you have no private life. That's it. So the beginning of your media personality when you join is you sacrifice your privacy. Okay. That's the first thing. Mm. Then the second thing is that there is judgment upon you.
Whether from, fair or not.
Yes, from the day you go on television and the day you become
the
popular.
Shoe that you wear.
It doesn't matter. Everything, your hairstyle, your shirt, your shoes, your socks, you know, your scent, depending on where you are, what you drink, what mode of
where
transport.
You hang out.
Yeah, what mode of transport.
And who you're married to. What or relating
I mean,
with.
I know one personality who got married recently whose partner got a lot of backlash on social media when he posted that he was getting married to this very beautiful lady, by the way. And some people just didn't like how she looked. And it really turned out to be a very unpopular post for those who would have loved to go and share in this very exciting news of his engagement. Yeah, people were just saying, you know, you can do better. Who said? Who decides for me what
exactly,
I want?
Exactly, this is what, a personal choice.
So, you sacrifice that. And it's one of the things I tell people coming into our space. Please note that from today on, you're sacrificing your private life. You're going to be a public personality. You're going to be judged from day one. Whether they know you or not, do not know you. There will be things written about you that you don't even know yourself. And so you have to have a thick skin.
Okay.
There is people who've actually gone into depression because, you know, they've been frustrated in our space. And it's very unfair on especially young journalists. But also, I did meet somebody who joined journalism straight out of university, was very lucky to get a job in one of the media houses. But she didn't last more than 2 years because she was very disappointed with the outcome of her job, and her expectations were not met because you have this, there is this blueprint everyone thinks is out there when you come to the media, that the moment you become a journalist, you know, you're going to be, first of all, you're going to be very popular, you're going to have your social media account is going to get more followers, you're going to do to meet all the most important people, but it turned out that when she joined, it was very clear that she was a novice and she was new in the industry. And so it was going to take her another 3-4 years to get to where some people already are, where she wanted to be. And it's very difficult to jump the gun. You cannot join the media now and say you want to be a senior journalist. You must earn it.
Yeah, true.
And so the cost sometimes of getting to where you are, and I know you've discussed it previously on your show, is not necessarily worth it, because there is harassment on the job by both your employers or your colleagues, and also your supervisors, and also the interview subject. So people you want to interview about a story you're developing. And so the job doesn't necessarily, it looks very glossy from the outside, but isn't necessarily very glossy when you get in. And so you must be very careful, and you need mentorship. Especially from people who've been in the industry, to help you understand that these are some of the jumps and these are some of the, you know, the lows, and these are some of the highs you need to expect, and these are some of the areas where there is a very thin line between being a very good journalist or TV presenter and actually doing a very horrible job and losing your job, or even just losing your space.
So should public opinion matter on who you date or marry?
No, never. It's about you.
It shouldn't.
It's about you and your partner.
What about your audience? I mean, you have an audience. Some people feel like they are accountable to the audience. They want to explain everything. They want to make sure that they are acceptable because they have a following. And I don't know, they've built their confidence, their trust, or the success of their career upon the audience or the following that they have. And so the audience dictates who they date, what they do, what they will not do, what they will wear. Others will have to, you know, wear fake brands. But let's bring it back to who you date or who you marry. Should public opinion matter?
Never. Should never matter. And that's, for me, where the beginning of your problems as a personality, media personality, will start. The day you start doing or listening or approaching your life and values based on what people are saying on social media is the day you're bound to fail. And by the way, a lot of the people that you're talking about who have actually succumbed to that pressure that, you can call it peer pressure, but it's media pressure or fan, your fan base.
Yeah, yes.
Actually, either unmarried or unsuccessfully married. So they've not necessarily kept a partner because they've either listened to what the people are saying online about their partners, or they've kept trying to appease their fan base. Prosy, that's for me where the biggest challenge is with our personalities today. The moment you start listening to your audience, not through research, because remember, we as media houses and as UBC, and by the way, I need to tell you, maybe if you don't know, that your show does very well, because the numbers show that your show does very well, and that's why you're still on air.
Yes.
Of course, it's adult content, so we run it very late, which is something the media people have told us. No, it comes too late, and we've said it's very adult content, so it may not be able to run at 9 p.m.
Yeah.
So for me, I think research can be done, and you need to do research, which we do as media organizations. First of all, to understand what your audience is like, but also to understand what your audiences want you to do better at, so that you can recruit more audiences. But the day as a media personality, you start turning to your social media feed and listening to what people are saying about your clothes, your makeup,
personal
your partners,
is
the day you're bound to fail in our space.
Okay.
Because it means you don't have your own personal values and you're now appeasing that audience. And by the way, Prosy, viewers are a moving target.
Okay.
Today they are with you.
Tomorrow they are not.
Tomorrow they are not. Mm-hmm. And we've seen this with some of the personalities here in Uganda. Mm. You know, last 2 years it was someone else, and they quickly move on to another person. Look at what's happening in the music industry. Somebody has a huge fan base, and the day he stops doing music, they've moved on.
Yeah.
So you need to be extremely careful. But what's very important, especially with your personal values, is that you must set set your own values and goals, and decide that that's what you're going to do. So you have your do's and don'ts. And one of the biggest don'ts in any media personality's life should be never to succumb to fan-based pressure. That will be the biggest problem. You can consult your fan base on who they want you to interview. That's fantastic.
That's fine.
But don't ask them who you should date.
Relationship, or what you should do about your relationship or your marriage, you know? Okay, so what about, I've heard rumors of people who date, fake dating, just because they want to appear like they have actually a partner, they have somebody. Actually, I've heard that there's some, I don't know how true this is, but that some media houses would actually put on pressure some media personalities to have somebody, to have some sort of drama going on around their relationship life, or maybe somebody they are dating that is also a public figure, so that they can attract some sort of viewership, increase in the viewership of the program that the person is doing. How true is that?
Well, that's very true. We've seen this happen with artists who are about to have concerts, and then all of a sudden you hear they're having marriage issues. I think that with the mushrooming of many private TV and radio stations, a lot of the gossip we hear is not necessarily gossip and not necessarily untrue. It's actually very stage managed.
Wow.
And we've seen that also happen in Europe, where you know, celebrities have stage managed certain events in the run-up either to a concert or in the run-up
a
to the release.
Project.
Yes, the release of a movie or the release of a TV series.
Yeah.
So it's common space. But what others have done, which is a very smart thing to do, is that depending on who the lead personality is for a program or a project or a TV series or a movie, you can actually build around their personality. You don't necessarily have to create a fake
drama
platform.
Or a fake, yes.
Yeah, you don't have to. Mm. I'll give you a quick example. Just most recently, we've seen Spare, the book released by Prince Harry.
By Prince Harry.
It's selling off the hook. What Prince Harry did in the run-up to the release of the book was do as many media interviews where he leaked snippets of his book. He didn't have to create a scandal to get sales for his book.
He's a prince.
Well, he has a good story.
Yeah, he has a prince. There are so many to be different.
There's so many girls who would want to get married to, you know, a prince. So I guess everyone wants to know what exactly is happening inside. So I totally agree with you that there will be media houses that will either recruit, by the way, or manage a particular event, either to bring in numbers, to create a buzz.
Oh, and lately trending, there's,
yeah, I was about to say that. And lately there's something called trending.
Yeah,
so they
trending.
Say, oh, we were trending at number one.
Yes.
But because of, you know, some certain event that they created.
Something that they created around the life of a
You've heard about people getting fired and then they've actually not been fired.
Yes,
and, you
know,
or relationship breakup.
Exactly. That's what I'm talking about.
At the launch of a new TV station or a rebrand or whatever.
After you have a lot of drama happening, you're creating, you know, a breakup between your husband or your fiance, and then you're trending. If you know it, you get, you know, promoted. You get a better show.
There's been media scandals about relationships in newsrooms and TV stations about personality A dating personality B, and most of the time those come out when there is either a new product they are launching. Or something they're trying to do as a media house. That's sometimes it's a marketing tool. I don't think it's fair on the personalities that are involved in that conversation, because a lot of the content that is shared stays online. And so the day anyone is trying to do research about you, maybe a company wants to give you an influencer role, and they pick this up, they may not necessarily give you business because they picked up something that doesn't resonate. A lot of these corporate companies have values that they, you know, aspire to, and they may not associate with you based on something very small that you were linked to, either linked to, alleged to have been part of, or even something you posted.
I have remembered something, but I will seek your permission whether we should ask or actually let it run. There was a story that I ran into online about you divorcing.
Yes, I think I've heard that. It's a public.
Actually, I had to Google and I'm like, And then actually there were allegations of who you had apparently, you were relating with.
Yeah, I think what's been good for me and my wife is that we've not let, you know, gossip and social media come to destruct our relationship or our family. We are in a space where we understand the business of media. People must sell either newspapers or must get hits.
A blogger.
Yeah, they must get hits on their website.
I know.
And so I hear a couple of those. I have recently, someone sent me something where they were asking me about something while I was in high school. And I don't remember
something
it.
Something that you did where you were in...
That so I was, while I was at university.
They are bringing it up right now.
They were writing a profile.
Wow.
You know, the stories about, did you know about? And half of the things that they were telling me I have never been part of, I didn't even know. And I've never seen it anyway. But it is interesting that this digital space allows for people to share falsehoods because they're looking for hits, like you said, and want their articles to trend. But I think we are now not the people giving them content. There is better people, younger people, younger, you know, TV personalities who are giving them good content. Every day there is something coming out.
Okay. So maybe the thing that I wanted to ask that I have seen prevalent in media personalities, why is it that most of the media personalities' marriages don't last? Okay, some of them. The marriages, they don't last. Relationships, you hear today they are engaged to this person, tomorrow it is another one, 2-3 years, someone comes and gets, you know, a very huge introduction, you know, before you know it, 2-3 years down the road, you hear that, you know, that ended in tears. And then someone is married before you know it, they have actually gone ahead to separate or divorce. What could be the challenge?
Well, I think it's actually worked both ways. For example, in my space, you know, we make 17 years in marriage this year, and I think it's been great. You know, it's not that, not to say that it's not had its challenges, but I think the fact that we were both in the media made it easier for us to relate, and that speaks to some of the challenges our people are having. So first of all, we work late hours. We spend a lot of our time at work, so there is very little private time, with the exception of your off days. And then you're a popular personality, and so again that comes with its own challenges. And so the first challenge you have with media relationships is the working hours. We work very late hours. And so if you get married to your colleague, especially somebody in the same space, it's highly likely, for example, in my former job. Mm. And even when I met my wife, when we got married, she had to leave and join another media house because it wasn't allowed, you know, in that organization to be married to somebody within your same department.
Okay.
So one of you needed to leave, or one of you needed to leave the department and join another department. And so because she was already in the department, she had to leave and join another media organization. So that normally is frustrating because then the fact that you're all working late hours and it's highly likely you're getting back home at different hours. And a lot of the times, by the way, for a lot of young journalists, you're invited to a lot of great functions that end late in the night. These really create a lot of friction because there's very little time, especially at the beginning of relationships.
Okay.
Those you know what it is like when you're just married.
Mm-hmm.
It's very young and you all don't understand this space. It's very new to you and you're beginning to build a relationship. And the fact that you're not in each other's space and you're supposed to be each other's support structure and you're no longer there, that begins to create the you know, the cracks in that relationship. And so the first thing normally is the work environment. It's very stressful. It's very likely that you will get home and you don't even have the energy to have a discussion. I mean, you know,
to have an intimate conversation.
Or even have an intimate conversation. Or even have, you know, that intimate relationship that you have. So you go back to work and home, and half the time you're with your partner, you're still discussing work. Because all of you are in the same space.
Mm.
And so there is no relationship. I mean, you discover that there is no longer a relationship. It's just a work relationship.
Mm.
Then the next thing usually is the temptation around the job.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Yes, you're surrounded by all these very nice looking men and women.
Just to cut you short, are the nice looking men and women only in the media houses?
Well, the media houses always pick some of the best looking people. They're everywhere. Well, they are, but you see what the biggest problem is, and I've seen this in Big Brother. If you watch Big Brother, you will notice that when you put people in a space, in a bubble together, there is bound to be relationships. And that's why, first of all, there is a lot of media personalities getting married to each other.
Yeah.
Because you're in each other's space.
Face.
Now, the moment that, for example, there is a change, for example, one of the partners leaves or one of the partners is working elsewhere, the people that surround you, because remember, you're spending up to 16 hours a day, 16, 18 hours a day with the same people. There is a lot of temptation.
Yeah.
And
companionship is created around the people that you spend most of your time with.
And remember, our space, our field, involves a lot of travel. So you're up country, in the field, you're out of the country, in the field, with the same people, there is bound to be temptation.
Yeah.
And finally, the moment you become a personality, a TV personality, radio personality, whoever it is, you have a fan base, a very huge fan base, but you also have people who really, really, really like you.
Admire you.
And admire you.
Mm. Your fans become admirers before you know. They start apparently saying, we are in love with this person.
And the, some of them will actually go out
approach.
Of their way to approach you.
Mm-hmm.
And we've seen, and not just, by the way, the young fans. It could also be the old fans who have the resources to look for you.
Do people approach you?
Well, I think now I'm too old. I'm not as approachable.
When I was younger, I'm old.
You're not retired yet.
Proceed,
let me tell you.
She should come and disagree that you are not.
I say that all the time. So she says I shouldn't
Please
say it.
Please stop saying
yeah,
it. No. I agree with you.
I tell her my gray hair doesn't help.
Mm-mm.
Anyway.
We should start dying it.
So I like that. Proceed. So when I was younger, you'd get the random phone calls. Or you get the, you know, you go into a public space and there's people coming.
Even as a guy?
Yeah. You go into a public space and there's people coming
and
to you.
And the ladies are the ones calling you?
Well, they'll come. Now these guys
they
call
have
it.
To be ladies,
now these young boys. And I see your crew has very young boys.
We don't expect young guys to be calling you. They have to be ladies.
Well, now, of course, it has to be ladies. But now you see these young, you know, your crew is very young. They call it, they come into your DM. For us, we didn't have DM that time. They had to either call you. That was the option. No one was going to slide into your SMS. Remember, our communication was either SMS.
Yeah.
We had Yahoo. There was a Yahoo chat.
Hotmail.
There was a chat. You know, if you're online and you're on email, you could easily chat with someone.
Mm.
So if, for example, you were on Yahoo and you had somebody's email, you're able to chat with them. Or you're able to send them an email. And so you got those. And by the way, the station, the media houses we worked for always had a public email or a public phone. So there was those random phone calls you'd actually get while you're at work. And somebody says, hi, I'm so-and-so. I just called to say hello, hi, can I meet you? It was very common. But the girls got more calls than the men, trust me.
Okay.
Yeah.
You did get the call. Okay, all right. So, yeah, those are the challenges that you have highlighted, and I do agree with you. But there's one more thing that I would like you to maybe expound on. How about our perceptions as, now I'm saying our because I am included.
You are.
The perception, there's this arrivalism that happens when you get, you know, onto the TV station, radio station, and people are calling and praising and exalting you, and somehow you start to feel you're too big for the person that has been with you before you were nobody, you know, and then there's this change of mindset. Somehow you think, no, I deserve better. I need somebody who is also in a public, you know, office or maybe also in the media so that we can start trending. And somehow there's a shift of perception. There's a shift of your values. You forget who you are and where you come from just because people are throwing nice comments. So maybe you have a following. What do you have to add on that?
It's coming. It's becoming very common lately. We've seen media personalities raise their threshold. You know, if somebody was, you know, a very humble person, from a very humble background. I'll give you a quick example. One of the most popular TV personalities, a lady, came for an interview, job interview, about 6 years ago. And she failed it, literally failed it. She couldn't openly speak. We doubted her degree. And, you know, fast forward, she's one of the most popular TV people I know right now.
Okay.
Whatever she does, they literally follow. It's interesting that her profile has totally changed from the time we met her when she came for this interview. We knew nothing about her until that first time we had an interview with her. But now he's one of the biggest brands and a big influencer in this country. And for me, I think the fact that that profile grew from where she was before to who she is now sometimes demands that you associate with a certain type of person. And so we've seen people who joined the media, for example, and were very young, but very, you know, hardworking, and built a good profile because of their hard work and the amount of time they put into their product, begin to start shifting from who they were as a person when they started out to this new brand. And again, probably I'm thinking, following instructions of their fan base. And a lot of these have moved away from their first relationships and they are now into another relationship, and most
or
of the time
a marriage.
Yeah, and most of the time they are now seeing people who have a bigger profile, people who have some money
especially,
and people who are able to afford the lifestyle they want.
Exactly, that is what I wanted us to really highlight on the payment. There's this belief or maybe this imagination that because you're every time somebody will get to watch you every 7, 8 a.m. or 7 p.m. you're on their TV screen and they are saying, oh, she has the money. I remember when just a few months of airing right here, this show, The Garden of Eden, people in my village started calling me, and then my dad somehow started getting attention and people started looking at the wrong things that are wrong with my family, that are wrong with at home where I come from. But Prosi, Averaku TV, I needed a but. What about
they can't even put paint
I know.
On their house.
And then they have this expectation. So there's this belief that because you're on somebody's screen and I'm wearing makeup and a pretty dress, we have money and so we must live up to that.
And they forget that half the time we are renting all these things. Yeah,
that, we have collaborations with boutiques and
all these guys. Half the time, you know, the clothes, the set, they think it's your house, you know. I worked for a very long time with the late Rosemary Nankabira and everyone thought I was married to her. In fact, I used to meet people and they'd say, how's your wife, Rosemary? And I was like, no, you know, she's not my wife. That's just my calling. But yeah, so there is this image that is built for you by, you know, the audience. And then they'll start judging you from the vehicle you're driving, like we said, the shoes you're wearing. Never have a bad day, hair day. Have a bad hair day, they will tell you. Or they will post it somewhere. Oh, I met one of my favorite TV personalities, but I was so disappointed. They had no makeup on, their hair was undone.
Yeah, we thought she has a smooth skin.
Exactly. They forget there was makeup. Mm. And so it's very important that you remain very humble. And I think that's what probably has also worked for me and my wife, is that you don't go far away from who you really are, even if you have this platform. This is a great platform, and I'm glad, Prosy, that your foundation on the Garden of Eden is around the Bible and what the values and the Christian values are for marriage and relationships. Mm. And we shouldn't go very far away from what the Bible says about who we are as people. And that's normally where the beginning of the problems is, that we build a picture of who we want to be, and we then set out to be that kind of person. I have seen people who have had to either borrow money to drive a certain car because that's what they want to be seen to do. Mm. And they've struggled to pay these loans, and then it comes to bite. There was a time when media personalities used to be in the papers all the time because they had defaulted on their loans.
Yeah.
But it was because we were trying to build a profile of who we wanted to be. Mm. You've had cases where some of the media personalities in the past were caught in small acts of theft.
Yeah.
You know, you find a media personality is stealing a mobile phone.
Wow.
At a public event or at a concert or something like that. Mm. Just because they must meet a certain standard. I have known in the past about musicians who were caught stealing, you know, petty things. Just because they can't live to a certain standard that their fans expect of them. Mm. That is the same thing with our relationships. And so the challenge we have, and this is because the media doesn't actually pay, and I agree with you, we don't pay well.
Especially in fact, here in Uganda.
In fact, across all platforms, it doesn't matter. I mean, there was a famous 50K. I hope you people
remember
the famous 50K.
The famous 50K.
And it's a fact that you were getting paid per hour. In fact, we had to revise. There was a time when we had to revise our payment model for presenters. Because remember, a presenter comes in and does 1 hour, 2 hours a day and walks away. But they are paid a monthly salary. So the media owners and media managers started looking at that as very expensive. How does this guy walk in? For example, you have some presenters who just do a one-weekly show. I mean, you have Prosy who does a one-weekly show. But Prosy is going to probably take the same salary as a news anchor who comes in 4 days a week. And so there was an imbalance. And so to kind of create a semblance of a balance, they said, we're going to count man hours, man working hours. And that also affected the how much these artists were going to get. We actually call presenters artists because it's an art.
Yeah, true.
And a lot of them actually left, you know, some media organizations because of that new payment model that wasn't necessarily very good for them. But to tell the truth is that, yes, the media gives you a great platform, but there's really very little money. Now, a lot of the young people who come in are very excited. They want this beautiful job. And then when they get in and they see how much money they are making, it kind of takes them back. And they're surprised. Oh, many have been around for 20 years earning peanuts?
Yeah.
And how have you survived? From the outside, we think you're very okay. But remember, no one is coming to visit you at home. So they probably don't know how your children are feeding, where your children go to school. And if you notice, a lot of media personalities, you will probably not know a lot about their private life. Because if they put it out there, you're going to start judging them.
Where
their children go to school.
See.
Yes. Mm. But to be honest, the current generation, which I think is really good, have found ways around making or earning a living through the same media platform. Mm. So the traditional media is still giving them a platform or a vehicle that is leading them to where they can actually make more money. If you look at most of the ads that are being done now, if you look at the influencers on social media, if you look at the MCs, let me just even share, just the people hosting events and MCing
events,
at all these corporate events, it's the same media personalities. So a lot of these media personalities are actually earning more money outside the traditional media space. But remember, they built their profile from the traditional media space.
Okay.
So yes, there is no pay. But if you're very smart and hardworking, the money comes.
There is no pay. You look good.
No, the money comes at the end of the day. I think for me, I mean, if you join the media now and you want to be Mugisha, it's difficult. I've done 17 years.
17 years, wow. You'd have to.
So you may have to to catch up a little bit. But you know, the young people are probably getting there faster than we did, because we started a long time ago when there was literally no pay.
All right, at this moment, we are going to take a short break and sip on our cup of coffee. We'll be back in just a moment. Don't you go anywhere.
Discover a whole new dimension at Win 5 Hotel, located in Nakasero, former Pearl of Africa Hotel. Come enjoy the most spectacular view of Kampala City, with the best facilities in town and perfect venue for your own fitness, relaxation, leisure, events, business meetings, and delicious new cuisine with an international touch. At Win 5, luxury meets comfort.
Welcome back from that short break. You're still in the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor this Sunday evening. And if you've just joined us, actually, we are about to close. Yes, if you've just joined us, I would like to encourage you to go to our YouTube channel at Marriage Anchor and start from the very beginning where we started from, so that you know where we are coming from before you do hear our conclusion. Or if there's a friend that has not watched and you know they've not joined you to watch with you, do share the link from our YouTube channel so that they can be able to benefit and learn from the information that my fine boss here in the garden. I can compliment somebody nicely and gently and I'll get away with it. My fine boss here, what he has been sharing. Of course, I told you he's the Deputy Managing Director, UBC TV. So I am humbled to have you once again. So before I let you go, what do you think is the impact on social media on marriages and relationships generally?
Well, I think there is two sides to every, question. Mm. And for me, I think there is some positives because I think a lot of media personalities are mentors of a lot of young people, especially in the media. But also, a lot of young people look up to these personalities. Mm. And most of the time someone says, I want to be like Prosy, I want to be like Maurice when I grow up.
Even when they do not know the reasons as to why I do the things that I do.
Exactly. But maybe it's through the way you act, you take yourself. If they've been in public spaces where you are, they want to associate with you. Mm. They want to aspire to be who you are, maybe be the next Prosy on TV. Mm. They like your presentation style. They like the fact that you do research in your content. Mm. And so the positives would be that, you know, when you share your story, especially, for example, yourself, when you do these interviews, when you post your pictures, you know, with your guests, there is people there out there that are aspiring to be you and are building their career around the things that you do and how you do what you do. There will be people looking out for your outfit and want to look like you look, and they probably think they would look very good in the same outfit. There will be people who, for example, will track your social media feed to see your skin routine. I think you know that a lot
of people have asked me what I do to keep looking like
exactly
this after these many children.
There will be people like that, and so I think for me there is those advantages. I also know some people who share, you know, bits about their families, even when it's a bit private, but also very managed. Mm. That also inspires young people to join this marriage space, because there is a lot of young people who are very uncomfortable with this space. Mm. But there's also people in their 30s and 40s who are unmarried and have always been scared about jumping into this space. Mm. And so when they see, for example, Prosy sharing a picture with her husband in a national park or at a private dinner, just a picture, you know, you kind of feel like you want to be Prosy. Mm. You want to be
You're
in that
inspired
space.
To want to fall in love,
yes,
or to believe.
You're like, I also want my plus one to do things like this for me. Mm. And so that is great. And I think people who are in good relationships should continue to share their stories. Mm. I have seen, for example, one particular marriage where, and she's a TV personality, where herself and the husband have now started doing relationship tips. Mm. I think they're doing both financial literacy, they're doing relationship tips, they're doing mentorship, they're doing coaching. And so they're sharing shorter clips on their social media platform, which I think is great because there's people who've probably liked this lady on television. She's now begun a new chapter in her life. She's been married for maybe 5 years now, but has begun opening up because I always thought she was very private, like myself, and not many people knew about her partner. But now her partner, she's actually the one recording, and you can tell she's the one recording these shows and is the interviewer because she's always asking the husband the questions. But on they also discuss, issues around their relationship. I've seen, for example, the most popular one, Brian Mulondo and the wife. They do, I think, a regular TV show, which is recorded in their car, about the regular things that happen to couples. Whether it's what do you talk about while you're in the car, what happens, you know, while you're looking after children, how do you manage children in relationships. And so it's great. And you can use social media to inspire, aspire, and also encourage young people to join the space. The other
what about on the negative
side? The flip side for me is I think we give away too much sometimes, and then you open up spaces for people to start judging you. So you've seen where people are showing off, they're flying in business class, they're holidaying in Dubai.
You want to do what you cannot afford because you saw your fellow
they're holidaying in Dubai. And I think for me that's an unfortunate kind of engagement, because you kind of are indirectly closing out a group of people that would want to be you, but know they will never afford to be you, and so you're creating a false impression. Because sometimes I travel quite a bit. Most of the times, and I need to be honest with you, most of the times my trips are paid for. So if I decided to post my trip every single time I travel,
someone would think, oh, fetuna traveling ako diba nange.
But also that, oh, ina sente nyinyi ngata ambula nako. They forget these are tickets provided by the corporate companies I'm working for, or events I'm actually going to be part of. And so that's an unfortunate scenario. We, I think, also share too much about what we are and who we are and where we want to be. And I think sometimes we then get judged very harshly. I'll give you an example. There is a lot of people in relationships who have turned social media into another relationship. So you're in you're in a relationship with Prosi, but you also have a special relationship with your social media platform. I have seen relationships that have failed because partners would learn of where their partners are on social media. They never discussed it. For example, you know, we were together in the morning, we had a good morning, we had breakfast together.
You didn't tell your wife that you were going to be here.
Exactly.
And then someone does a clip and they are posting.
The next thing, there is a social media post and there is something where you're actually going to talk about your partner and she didn't have a clue about it. So where is the communication in the relationship? And so those gaps need to be addressed. And I think social media has provided us those unfortunate spaces where people know too much about you and your partner doesn't. And I think also this idea of you must share everything about you. You're posting pictures every day. Everything is out there.
You keep updating them.
So how private are you? And what is it that you have that your partner, yourself and the partner share that nobody else knows? What is it about you that your partner doesn't know? That you know that your partner knows and is exclusive to the relationship that others do not know about. If your relationship is very public, I don't know if it's now really a private relationship between the two of you, or it's become a public relationship. We've seen, for example, TV series that have been done around personalities in the US, married personalities, reality TV shows. And 90% of these reality TV shows,
actually, they are staged. It is pure drama.
Forget even the staging. Is that the relationships have not worked after that.
Yeah.
And half the time, sometimes even within the same reality shows, we discover that these were acted. And then behind the scenes, people actually broke up. But they will not show us that because they want to create a certain image. And when the series is wrapped up, you start to pick up the pieces of, oh, wait a minute. Actually, the last episodes were done when these guys were divorced. So, I think
relationship. There's a lot of deception, there's a lot of pretense, there's a lot of shred, drama, and all that.
Relationships, in my view, need to remain very private.
Okay.
And it's something between you and your partner. And I'm happy to see a lot of my friends in the media, keep a private life on their media platforms. So, you find a very nice profile of this person, but you know nothing about their marriage and their relationship because you don't see it on their platforms. But they're happily married and they have great children, and their husbands are happy with who they are. None of you knows who they are. Yeah, and I think it's working out for them.
All right. Is there anything you'd like to say that maybe we've left out, maybe a parting shot to people, especially that are aspiring to join the media? Is there anything you'd like to encourage them to do?
Well, Prosi, first of all, I want to thank you for the opportunity to come and talk about relationships in the media space. It's a conversation we can talk about until cows come home.
Yeah, sure.
But I must say that, for starters, most of the people we get to associate with in our lives, and the people that come to be who we want them to be, our partners for life, in marriage, usually are people who should understand you and should believe in your values, and you have shared values. A lot of the times you discover that those persons or the personalities that you're looking out for are within your same workspace. And for us as journalists, we've actually found that when you date your colleague or your workmate, they probably understand you more than anybody outside there, because your profile that is built when you're on television is totally different from who you really are as a person. So I have seen two Prosis. I know the Prosi that's on set right now, but I've also seen the private Prosi who is not on set. And those are two different people.
Yeah, true.
And unless somebody knows who you are, your private person, it's very difficult for them to understand that you have specific values you aspire to, and that you can only judge that person based on who they really are as a private person. And so most of the relationships we have with our partners should be really about who we are, not what we are on air and what people see. But I think half the time is that we are battling the who we are on air and what people think we are and who we really are as a person. And I really would like to encourage a lot of my colleagues and friends, especially people who want to join the media space, or even people in our media space who have picked partners or are thinking of having partners in the same workplace. And this speaks to, by the way, even people in other professions but are dating people in the same workspace, is that the relationship is really about the two of you, just the two of you.
Yeah.
And that the rest of the things you hear outside of the two of you is noise. I call it noise.
Yeah.
And I think when we're all buying these nice gadgets, you know, I've seen earphones and headsets that say, is it noise filter?
They have the
great filter. I think we need to create filters, marriage filters, or relationship filters that lock out the noise. Because the relationship is about you and your partner. And it's only the two of you that can decide and determine where you want to go. And for relationships that have worked, mine has worked for 17 years. It's coming to 17 years. I've known my wife for 20 years. Is because we have decided that we have a path we want to take. And that's worked out for us. It's working. We are happy to share our blueprint, but it may not necessarily work for you. But we think that if you lock out the noise, and you kill that noise, and you decide that this is where you want to go and how you want to get there, you'll have a great marriage, you'll have a fantastic relationship with your partner, and you'll build a great relationship with your children, because the outsiders are not determining where you want to go as a unit. And so, for me, I think, and the best thing I can tell people is just kill that noise that is outside of your relationship, outside of your home, and just trust in your own values and run with that, and you will be very happy.
Alright. Thank you so much, Mr. Maurice.
Pleasure.
Mugisha, for coming into the Garden of Eden. We are looking forward to having you over and over again.
Thank you.
But next time with somebody by your left side.
Yes, I'll definitely come with my wife next time.
Would love to meet her. Alright, at this point, before we do close the show, I would like to appreciate Win 5 Hotel, Nakasero that has since replaced Pearl of Africa Hotel for hosting the Garden of Eden TV show. We are grateful. If you have a wedding, a function, if you want to come and enjoy the nicest of food, I was speaking to their director and he told me that one of their specialty or something new to look forward to at now Win 5 Hotel is the food, you know. So you want to come and check out new things that are happening at Win 5 Hotel Nakasero. For us are here, me and my fine boss, it's a wrap. Good night. God bless you.
Thank you for connecting to the Marriage Anchor. For more information, call us on 0702-767-602 or 0782-958-875. Email us at themarriageanchor@gmail.com. Like and follow us on Facebook, The Marriage Anchor. Twitter, Anchor_Marriage. Instagram, Marriage_Anchor. Check our YouTube channel at Marriage Anchor for all our previous episodes. The Garden of Eden, a test of heaven's romance.
Take me to the garden. I can't resist the feeling. Take me to the garden. I wanna feel my belonging. Take me to the garden. I am yours.
And you are mine.
My heart is yours.
And you alone.
Take me to the garden.